Shalom. Today we continue with the Hebrew alphabet, the Aleph Bet. We're learning the letters two at a time. I have revamped the font chart to help you find some of the letters. I put the numerical values over each letter, and you will see five pairs of letters that are bracketed together. Last time we learned the Yud that is worth 10, and you can see it under the 10. The next two letters are bracketed. The amount for 20. 30 is a single letter. The amount for 40 is bracketed for two letters. Also 50. Also the ones for 80 and 90. And the reason that there are two forms is that these five letters have a special final form. When this letter appears as the last letter in a word, it will take this secondary final form. I will leave a link in the description for you to find this new font chart, and I suggest that you print it off and have it handy. So the first letter we're going to learn today is the Nun, and you'll find it under that bracketed pair with the number value of 50. Remember, we're counting from the right to the left. So the Nun is the 14th letter of the alphabet, but there are two of them, and so it's going to be the 16th figure on the chart. The Nun is characterized by a narrow shape, and its picture meaning is like a little fish or a little tadpole. Sound for this letter is like our N sound. N. The second letter we're going to learn today is the Samech, and you can see it under the number value 60. It is round, 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 and its picture meaning is a thorn. The sound is a plain S sound. So together these two letters spell the word Ness. And if you remember, if you have celebrated Hanukkah, there's a saying that we find four first letters are on the four sides of the dreidel or the little top that is traditional for the holiday. And the four letters stand for Nes. This is our word today, Nun Samech. Nes Gadol Haya Sham. Nes in post-biblical Hebrew means a miracle. Not in biblical Hebrew, but in post-biblical Hebrew. Gadol is big, haya is was, and sham means there. Nes gadol haya sham. A great miracle happened there, but it happened in Israel. So if you go to Israel and you find a dreidel, which is, the Hebrew word is sevivon, because it's sevev, it goes around and round. The dreidels have the last letter pei. Nes gadol haya po. A great miracle happened here. So as we said, Ness as a miracle is not a modern word, but it is a biblical word that means a standard or an ensign, a pole or a banner, something to set up a marker. So we see it in Numbers 21:8, and Yehovah said to Moses, make thee a fiery serpent and set it upon a pole on a Ness. And it shall come to pass that everyone that is bitten, when he looketh upon it, shall live. And again in Numbers 26:10, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed them up with Korach. When that company died, what time the fire devoured 250 men, and they became a sign, a post, a marker of something that happened. In Psalm 60, verse 4, thou hast given a banner to them that fear thee, that it may be displayed because of the truth, Selah. And in Isaiah 11:10, and in that day there shall be a root of Jesse, which shall stand for an ensign of the people. To it shall the Gentiles seek, and his rest shall be glorious. So this is also the Ness. And this is the Ness that Yeshua talked about when he said in John 12:32, and I, if I be lifted from the earth, will draw all men unto me. Also referring to the serpent on the pole, which we just read about. Now there is a verb form, nisa, if we add a hey at the end, and that means to prove, to tempt, or to try. In Genesis 22:1, and it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham and said unto him, Abraham, and he said, behold, here I am. God does not bring us temptation to put us on a pass-fail test to get into heaven or for a judgment. But he proves him. He said, "What? Let me prove to Abraham who Abraham is. Did God know the outcome of what Abraham would do? Of course. But now Abraham has to face this kind of test, this trial, and now he knows what is in himself. In Exodus 17:7, and he called the name of the place Massah, which is also linguistically related to this Nisa to try, and Meribah, because of the chiding of the children of Israel, because they tempted Jehovah, saying, "Is Jehovah among us or not?" I recommend to you the commandment in Deuteronomy 6:16, do not put Jehovah your God to the test, as you did at Massah. Here is another test, Judges 6:39. And Gideon said unto God, "Let not thine anger be hot against me, and I will speak but this once. Let me prove, I pray thee, but this once with the fleece. Let it now be dry only on the fleece, and upon the ground let there be dew." So he put up a test for himself to see what was the will of Jehovah. Again in Daniel 1:12, "Prove thy servants, I beseech thee, 10 days, and let them give us pulse," which means vegetables, "to eat and water to drink." So it was a kind of test. Can they remain healthy without all the fancy food of the king? And the answer is, yes, you can. So sometimes when we have this kind of a test, it is like a marker, like a banner. Sometimes you even see them setting up some kind of altar to say, this is what happened here. So that is how the test is connected to the banner. There's another verb root, if we put the vav in the middle, nous, which means to flee. In Genesis 14:10, "And the vale of Siddim was full of slime pits, and the kings of Sodom and Gomorrah fled and fell there, and they that remained fled to the mountain." In Genesis 39, verse 12, talking about Joseph, "And she caught him by his garment, saying, Lie with me. And he left his garment in her hand and fled and got him out." Also we read of the cities of refuge, Numbers 35:6. "And among the cities which ye shall give unto the Levites, there shall be 6 cities for refuge, which ye shall appoint for the manslayer, that he may flee thither, and to them ye shall add 42 cities. If we think about a battle, maybe a more ancient battle, and in the thick of the fray, we don't know even if we want to retreat or we want to go back and take a little rest, we don't know which way to turn. We're going to turn and look for our banner, look for the standard of our side so we know which way to turn to run. In 1 Samuel 19:10, "And Saul sought to smite David, even to the wall with a javelin. But he slipped away out of Saul's presence, and he smote the javelin into the wall, and David fled and escaped that night." So, what month did the people flee from Egypt? It was the month of Nisan. You see the Nun and the Samech? If you want to learn more about the month of Nisan, you can check the video listed in the description box below. Now, before we continue, I want to put an end to a misconception, which is that the name, which in English people call Jesus, there is an idea floating around that this is a pagan name. This is totally untrue. In the first line here, we see verse Exodus 24 and 13, and the name highlighted there is Yehoshua, and in English it is written as Joshua. I have pulled up the Septuagint for you. The Septuagint is the Bible translated into Greek from Hebrew about 285 BCE, about 285 years before Yeshua was, can we say, a twinkle in his mother's eye. And the translation of the name Joshua into Greek is Jesus. Okay, you can see that there. You can kind of read those letters. Again, in Nehemiah 8:17, we actually see Joshua referred to as Yeshua. We know that it's him because he's the son of Nun. And again, in the Septuagint, you see that his name is Isu, Iu, Nun. The reason the final S is missing, as we saw in the previous slide, Isus, is because this is a genitive form. It's a form of belonging. It is the days of Yeshua, the days of Isu. So it has a different ending. But you can see that the name of Yeshua has always been Isus from before the translation of the Bible into English. Now, why are we talking about Joshua? Well, we're going to talk about Joshua and Joseph. The two amounts of Nun and Samech, we're talking about Ness, we're talking about the ensign who is lifted up that all the Gentiles will come to. This Ness, the value is 110. And there are two people specifically that are named as having lived to be 110 years old, and they are Joseph and Joshua, both types of Messiah. I'm sure you know much of the comparison of these two. Joseph was sold into slavery by his brothers. He was unrecognizable to his brothers. He was stripped of his robe. He was falsely accused, yet he remained faithful throughout his trial. Joseph's Egyptian name is Zaphnath-Paneah, which has variously been translated Savior of the World, Preserver of the Age, Revealer of Secrets. And even inside in a Hebrew context, if you take the consonants, it can mean the one who is hidden of face. Again, there's a video about the name Joseph that will also be in the description box. Another interesting thing about Joseph is that he is the father of Ephraim. And so what do we see about Yeshua in John 11:54? Yeshua therefore walked no more openly among the Jews, but went thence into a country near to the wilderness, into a city called Ephraim. There he continued with his disciples. And again in John 19:38, after this, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Yeshua, but secretly for fear of the Jews, besought Pilate that he might take the body of Yeshua, and Pilate gave him leave. And he came therefore and took the body of Yeshua. Now it turns out that Arimathea is a town called Ramathaim, and it is in the hill country of Ephraim. So here we have these two shadow pictures that the body and the person of Yeshua is being cared for, kept, and held by Ephraim. And who is Ephraim? Maybe you are. Comparing Joshua to Yeshua, he brought the people into the land. He fought the battles. There was a bombardment of stones during the battles. The people hid in caves. There was a trumpet judgments. There was a moment of silence and then a shout. There were the two spies who were like the two witnesses. Jehovah's people are rescued, and he defeats seven nations. So there's a great deal of parallel between the book of Joshua and the book of Revelation. Now we have said that there is always a counterfeit, and Yeshua is the sign, and he is the wonder. But in 2 Thessalonians 2:8-9, it is written, "And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power, signs, and lying wonders." So we need to have some discernment when we see signs and wonders. Where are they coming from? Because Satan will provide a counterfeit. And for the memory verse, this is not actually a verse, but it's a nice little saying that you can understand, and I hope that it's true. So we read, Nes Gadol Hayah Li, a great miracle happened to me. And if you belong to Yeshua, and I pray that you do, that is the greatest miracle you will ever see. Many times we're looking for things on the outside, the Red Sea to split, and things that we can experience as miracles. But the greatest miracle that you will ever personally know is what Yeshua has done to you and for you in your life. So next time we'll learn some more letters. In the meantime, Tasim et ha'einayim al hashamayim, keep your eyes on the sky, your redemption draweth nigh. Shalom.